Dipankar Gupta, fellow students. This is the very hall in which 30 years ago I participated in a freshers debate. So it's like a second homecoming to me. And I still recall that Professor Mulchand Sharma, then a very young lecturer, and Mrs. Sadhana Ramchandran were the judges. They adjudged me the winner on that day. I don't know whether I'll be able to keep up to that high benchmark, because you'll have to judge me after the delivery of this lecture. Today's subject is an interesting and has been a burning issue right since 1951. In point of fact, all of you know that our constitution was framed in 1950. And unlike the US constitution, it contained a fundamental rights chapter at the very beginning, at the start. The US constitution, which is much older, required several amendments to be made to it to incorporate the fundamental inalienable freedoms that we call human freedoms. And that itself took a reasonably long time. But we started off on a clean slate, as it were, and had an entire chapter, that is chapter 3, devoted to it. Now, one of the burning issues at that point of time was land reform legislation, because there were zamindars holding large tracts of land, and the Congress party had come to power, one of its main planks being that we wish to reverse all this and ultimately give land to the tiller. There were three legislations which were challenged in three high courts between 1950 and 1951. There was a UP Act, there was a Madhya Pradesh Act, and there was a Bihar Act, all challenged at the same time, or roughly the same time, in the respective high courts. Two of them were unsuccessful challenges. It is only the Bihar case where large portions of the act were struck down. Now, this caused tremendous consternation in the then ruling Congress party, Pandit Nehru being the prime minister at the time. And some device was required at that time in order to see that this particular plank on which the Congress party had actually come to power was put into effect, come what may. So what was devised then by way of our very first amendment was two articles which were added in the fundamental rights chapter itself, 31A and 31B. And the peculiar feature of this amendment is that in your very first amendment, you are putting in two articles to protect the Constitution against itself. I don't think this has been done anywhere else in the world. You are saying in one breath that, look, we have recognized fundamental inalienable human freedoms in part three. And on the other hand, you are saying that, look, when it comes to a certain category of laws, we want to ride roughshod over those freedoms. So we want to therefore protect a portion of the Constitution against itself. Now, when the enactment of the First Amendment actually took place, the speech given by Pandit Nehru was instructive. The speech was that, look, we have these land reform measures, there is a High Court that has struck it down, and we want to therefore press ahead, notwithstanding, and we don't want any courts, any lawyers, etc., in the way. He made one thing very clear, that the idea was only agrarian reform and nothing else. And he was very apologetic when he came to the ninth schedule, because he said that, look, this schedule now is being populated with 13 acts. I think 13 acts is a large number. Today, of course, as you know, it's been populated with about 250 acts, dealing with all sorts of subjects. But when he piloted that amendment, he made it clear that what we are looking to is only agrarian reform law, And despite the wide language of 31B, what we really want protected is agrarian reform law and nothing else. Now, strangely enough, the Fourth Amendment, which was passed 4 years later in 1955, added another 7 acts into this schedule in order to protect these laws against any onslaught by way of writ petitions filed in high courts. But 3 of these very acts dealt with matters which were not agrarian reform. One dealt with railways, one dealt with insurance, and one dealt with the Industries Development and Regulation Act. A particular chapter was sought to be protected. So the so-called promise that Pandit Nehru held out in his speech was belied in 4 years itself when he was Prime Minister in 1955. We already therefore have in the first 20 acts in the 9th schedule, 3 acts which are not agrarian reform measures. Now what is interesting is the First Amendment came up for challenge almost immediately. And a constitution bench judgment of Justice Patanjali Shastri, as he then was, in Shankardeep Prasad Singh's case in 1952, specifically turned down an argument, which argument was that, look, Article 13, unlike again the US Constitution, is explicit when it says that the state shall not make any laws which violate fundamental rights. And if any such laws are made, they will be declared void by courts. The question there raised was, is constitutional law also a law within the meaning of Article 13? Justice Patanjali Shastri found on a reading of 13 that yes, perhaps it could be included, but according to him, there were certain contraindications. And finally, the judgment was that, sorry, constitutional law can't possibly mean law under 13. And on that ground alone, therefore, a constitutional amendment can't be challenged. This held the field right until Sajjan Singh's case, which was decided about 13 years later, in 1965. By then, there was a 17th amendment, which was also passed, where the 9th schedule was now populated with a number of agrarian reform measures, which were about 43 acts. So 43 additional acts were now added in one shot, so to speak. And one of these acts came up for challenge in Sajjan Singh's case, again before a bench of 5 judges. This time, another novel argument was raised to challenge their constitutional validity. What was said was that Article 368, which is the amending provision, has a proviso which requires that certain parts of the constitution cannot be amended except by ratification by the states. One of them is Article 226. So the argument put forward was that, look, when you are in fact shielding laws by putting them in the 9th schedule, what you are doing is really pro tanto amending 226. And since you are amending 226, please go to the states for ratification. That argument was turned down by all the 5 judges. However, 2 of the 5, Justice Hidayatullah and Justice Mudolkar, expressed reservations over Shankardeep Prasad Singh's correctness, the 52 judgment, if you remember, and said that, look, we are not at all sure that constitutional law is not part of Article 13. In fact, Justice Mudolkar, in a separate judgment, expressly said that what if Article 32, which according to him, was part of the basic structure, he used these very words, interestingly enough, of the Constitution, in that it's an article which is itself a fundamental right in order that a person comes to a court to enforce other fundamental rights. If that article, which was described by Dr. Ambedkar as the soul, spirit of the Constitution, could be taken away without ratification by the states, what would be left of democracy? He gave that by way of example. And then he said, therefore, what we really need to go into is whether there are certain features of this constitution which are meant to endure for all time. And if they are so meant to endure, then would it be possible to take away such features? Now, with this query put forward, a full bench of 11 judges was then constituted in 1967. Chief Justice Subbarao at the head. And by a split decision of 6-5, they ultimately upheld the 1st, 4th and 17th amendments. You'll remember, these are the three amendments which not only introduced 31B, but also added these 63 acts in the 9th schedule. But they did it on a very peculiar footing. They overruled Shankari Prasad and said, sorry, Article 13 does include constitutional law. Now, if it does include constitutional law, straight away without more, 31B had to go. The acts in the 9th schedule had also to be struck down. But, said the Chief Justice, we will apply a doctrine foreign to our constitution, no part of the constitution, called prospective overruling. And by applying that doctrine, what we say is that what has happened till now can be allowed to pass muster, but from this date onwards, sorry, you can't touch fundamental rights. Now, this decision again had a very short-lived existence for about 6 years or so. In fact, by the fourth year, in 1971, another constitutional amendment was passed, which was the 24th Amendment, in which it was made explicit that 13 would not apply to constitutional laws. And 368 didn't deal only with the procedure to amend, it contained the substantive power of amendment. So out went Golaknath by the 24th Amendment. The 25th Amendment, in addition, added a new Article 31C, where for the first time, certain directive principles were given primacy over fundamental rights, in almost the same language as 31A. And the 26th Amendment took away privy purses. As you know, erstwhile Indian rulers, when they acceded to the Union, were given privy purses and a certain status. Those were taken away by the 26th Amendment. And finally, there was one more amendment, the 29th Amendment, which added two more laws, Kerala Agrarian Land Reform Law, to the 9th schedule. Now, all this came up for challenge before yet another larger bench in the landmark decision of Keshavananda Bharti, which was delivered in April 1973, this time by a bench of 13 judges. Again, by a split vote of 7-6, you remember the earlier split was 6-5. This is now 7-6. Seven judges laid down what Justice Mudolkar had foretold and said that, look, even though 13 may not apply to constitutional law, we accept that it won't apply. There are certain inherent implied limitations beyond which a constituent power cannot be exercised. And this is a gigantic step in constitutional law. Nowhere in the world has this ever been done before that. So that, according to the majority, if something went against, that is a constitutional amendment went against what they described as certain essential features or the basic structure of the constitution, that constitutional amendment would not pass muster and would have to be struck down. Now, close on the heels of this judgment, came the first test of this basic structure doctrine. And thank God they laid it down. Because otherwise, Article 329 capital A, which was introduced shortly thereafter, would have passed muster. In short, Article 329A was only this, that if you happen to be a prime minister or a speaker, you are above the law. What happened by way of 329A was that, look, if a high court has held that a certain prime minister or speaker of the Lok Sabha's election is held to be void on any ground, that judgment will not bind without more. Secondly, the law to be applied will not be the Representation of People Act. Thirdly, there is a void so that there is no law to be applied. And fourthly, any appeal pending from that judgment in the Supreme Court will be decided in accordance with this article. So in short, the Prime Minister and the Speaker were put above the law. No law was to be applied, and by a declaratory judgment in a constitutional amendment, whatever was said to be void by way of their election was validated. Now, this obviously would go against so many features of the Constitution. And if the split of 7-6 were the other way, it would have passed muster. And if it had passed muster, I don't think that there had been anything left of democracy in this country. So fortunately, 5 judges then again sat and deliberated on this amendment and all unanimously struck it down. Very shortly thereafter, during the emergency, there was another amendment now moved, the 42nd amendment, which again had a massive program of amendments. There were large numbers of articles changed. But what we are directly concerned here for the purpose of this talk is 2 sub-articles added to 368, which, if you remember, contains the power to amend. Now, there again, what they sought to do was to nullify the judgment in Kesavananda Bharti's case without changing the basis of the law. What they said was, any constitutional amendment shall not be touched by a court. And secondly, it is within the plenary power of Parliament to pass any amendment it chooses. Now, this happened to come up before a constitution bench in the first Minerva Mills case. Now, I must tell you, I was a student here between 1976 and 79. I passed out in July. I think I was enrolled as an advocate in July. Fortunately for me, the hearing in this Minerva Mills judgment took place sometime in November, if I remember right, of that year itself. And again, very fortunately for me, I happened to be the only junior with Mr. Nani Palkhivala, who actually argued the first Minerva Mills case, for the very good reason that he had promised in America that whatever was left of the 42nd Amendment, which was not undone by the Janata Party in the 44th Amendment, he would come and personally see that a court would undo. So we picked up one petition. Neither Mr. Palkhivala nor I were paid for that exercise. And I saw forensic ability at its highest for about 3 weeks, because it was a fantastic performance. And I'll never forget one of his most pithy phrases, one of the phrases he used at that time. And if you remember, I was a student just out of law college at the time. He said, Article 31C, because that was the bone of contention there, apart from 368, 4 and 5, has turned the Constitution on its head. Whereas fundamental rights are enforceable and meant to be enforced in courts, they are made unenforceable. And whereas directive principles of state policy, expressly by Article 37, are said not to be enforceable in courts, they have been made enforceable. So anyway, that hearing lasted for some 3 weeks. And at the end of it, both the offending parts, that is 368, 4 and 5, and 31C as amended, were struck down by the court, again applying the basic structure doctrine. And that brings us then to 2 other decisions, one in Bhim Singh Ji's case and one in Vaman Rao's case. And that is how really today's subject really springs into life, because it's the decision of 2 constitution bench judgments in these 2 cases that led to the reference to 9 in this Coelho's case. Now, what did Vaman Rao decide and what was Vaman Rao faced with? In Vaman Rao, there was a frontal attack made on the First Amendment itself, quite apart from 31C and 31C as amended. So 31A, B, C were all under challenge. It's important to note, in Vaman Rao, 31B was squarely under challenge. And finally, a constitution bench said that we uphold 31A and B, not because they've been there for so many years, or by applying the doctrine of prospective overruling, which was applied in Golaknath, but according to us, it's part of that early social philosophy or socialist philosophy of the constitution makers themselves. And since it was part of that philosophy, we uphold it without more. Bhim Singh Ji went on to consider as to whether the Urban Land Sealing Act, which was an act placed in the 9th schedule, would also violate any essential feature. Now, this again led to a very peculiar set of judgments. There were four judgments delivered in that case. Two minority judgments are complete in themselves, but they are minority judgments. Justice Tulsapurkar and Justice A.P. Sen, because they struck down large portions of the urban land ceiling. The three majority judgments struck down only one section, which was very innocuous in my submission, section 27.1. And that section only said that you cannot, even if you have land within the ceiling area, sell to any person for a period of 10 years without permission from some competent authority. Now, all five struck down that section. The trouble with the majority is that there is no reasoning for striking it down. What is interesting is Justice Krishna Iyer was due to retire in 2 days. So Chief Justice Chandrachud had to deliver an order, a short order, and he said reasons will follow. So he merely struck down 27.1 and said reasons will follow. Justice Krishna Iyer in his first paragraph says, I agree that 27.1 should be struck down without giving any reason. And 4 years later, when reasons came from Justice Chandrachud for the majority, he said, I agree with Justice Krishna Iyer without more. So the peculiar part of Bhim Singh Ji's case is that you have one section of an act in the ninth schedule struck down totally without reason. And you cannot go to the two minority judgments because they were minority judgments. They struck down 27 together with a whole series of other sections, which according to the majority passed muster. So these were the two judgments that in fact were the subject matter in some Gudalur Janmam Estates Abolition Act case, which is what I.R. Kohelo was. Now that came before again a bench of five judges, and all these questions were raised again. And Chief Justice Bharucha at that time, sitting in a combination of five, said that all this raises very important questions as to the validity of 31B, as to whether it can be constrained, and therefore we think that nine judges should look at the entire problem afresh. And that's how this nine-judge bench was ultimately constituted, in order to look at 31B afresh. Now, I find from a reading of the judgment one very peculiar statement made. And the statement is this, that 31B is not under challenge here. And the judges repeat it in two or three places. Strangely, because Vaman Rao itself was up for grabs. If you remember, Vaman Rao was itself, because it had inconsistencies, was itself the subject matter before nine judges. And Vaman Rao contained a specific challenge to 31B. But anyway, the court therefore proceeded on the wrong footing in my submission, that 31B itself was not under challenge, first. Second, it was faced with a direct problem. Are fundamental rights part of the basic structure of the Constitution, or are they not? Because till then, it was not very clear. There were all sorts of streams of thought. Some said it's the core of the right, not the penumbra. Some said it's not the language of the article, it's the concept that would be contained, say, in the preamble. The broader concept of equality, for example, not the language of Article 14. Now, all these theories were floating around, so that ultimately nine judges had to decide whether fundamental rights first and foremost are or are not part of the basic structure. I think it's a question which answers itself, because basic is equal to fundamental. They are interchangeable terms. So the moment you say that there is a basic or a fundamental right, naturally it has to be part of the basic structure. And it's very difficult then to say that even though these are inalienable rights, in the sense that they are natural rights, they are not something a constitution confers. By virtue of being human, you have these rights. Now, if these rights are not basic, then what is? And then what would be the difference between a democracy and a totalitarian state? Now, all these, fortunately, these things are today resolved. This is the one thing this judgment resolves. Because it does say that certain fundamental rights are part of the basic structure. Now, this is the problem. Which fundamental rights then are not part of the basic structure? The judgment goes on to repeat that, look, the right of equality contained in 14, various rights in 19, free speech, assembly, freedom of assembly, freedom to move throughout India, freedom to settle anywhere in India, right to business. All these are part of basic structure. And of course, above everyone else, 21, which is personal liberty. But then what about the others? So one of the things the judgment leaves unanswered is, are all fundamental rights part of basic structure or not? It appears that only certain fundamental rights are from the judgment and some are not. This is the first problem with the judgment. Now, the second problem is that the backdrop of this reference is very, very important because the 44th Amendment had made it clear that property rights now stand deleted. You will remember, you had property rights which zamindars used to challenge these legislations contained in Article 19(1)(f) and 31. Both 19(1)(f) and 31 were deleted in 1978. If this background is kept in mind, the entire relevance of 31B and the 9th schedule in my submission goes. Because what was 31B meant for, despite its very wide language? It was ultimately meant to protect agrarian reform laws. And agrarian reform laws came in the way of property rights of zamindars. Now, if property rights are removed from the constitution, as they have been removed after 1978, what is the justification for utilizing the 9th schedule? None. Now, that is one very important background fact which unfortunately is not there in this judgment. It's totally missing from this judgment. Therefore, if this is the important background fact, coupled with, of course, the fact that 20 and 21, which deal with personal liberty, have now been put on a higher pedestal than they were before, because now if an emergency is declared, 20 and 21 cannot be taken away, even though there's an internal emergency. If these two background facts are kept in mind, then it was very easy for the court to say, look, 31B has really spent its force. Now, you can't say that as a matter of law. You have to craft it. Now, what are the various ways in which this judgment could, in my submission, have been crafted? One would have been to say, look, it is confined to agrarian reform law, even though it doesn't explicitly say so. And it's easy to read 31B as such. Not only could you rely on Pandit Nehru's speech, you could also rely on the opening words of 31B itself. Because it opens with, without prejudice to the generality of Article 31A. 31A, nobody doubts, is confined to agrarian reform law. So therefore, the nexus between 31A and B is established by these opening words. So the judgment could have held that since this is only an added protection, something added to 31A, which is already there, it is obvious that it was meant for agrarian reform laws and agrarian reform laws only. Unfortunately, this judgment doesn't say so, nor was it invited to say so. This, according to me, would have almost completely spent the entire force of 31B and the 9th schedule. Because today, really, there are no other agrarian reform laws that you can put in for zamindar violations of property because there is no property right left. So had they confined 31B purely to agrarian reform laws, a lot of the sting would have been removed. Point one. Point two. 31B, unlike 31A, gives a blanket protection against all fundamental rights. It's very sinister. 31A, firstly, as you remember, is limited only to agrarian reform laws. 31B is not so limited. Second, 31A is limited to challenges made under 14 and 19 alone. Also to 31, but 31's gone. 31B is not so limited. 31B is against all fundamental rights. So it's a draconian provision. And the most draconian part is yet to come. The sting is really in the tail. Because the sting is, that notwithstanding that a final judgment, that is a Supreme Court judgment, says that a particular act is bad, you may without more just put that act into the ninth schedule by way of a constitutional amendment. Out goes the judgment, in comes the act. Now, this is very, very far-reaching. And fortunately for us, since Keshavananda Bharti's case, a large number of judgments have held that judicial review is very much part of the basic structure of the Constitution. In fact, it's something that emanates from the basic separation of powers doctrine. And that's why judgments have held incorrectly that, look, you, the legislature, cannot transgress into our field, the judiciary's field, and declare without more that a judgment is bad. What you can do is only to alter the basis of the law, either retrospectively or otherwise, and then say the law has now changed. And since the law has now changed, you would invite the higher forum, that is the appellate forum, to apply the changed law and not the earlier law. So that if you applied then only the changed law, you would reach a different result. Now, 31B doesn't say any such thing. 31B is a declaratory judgment by itself. It says straight away that, look, if there is any judgment in the way, whether of a high court or the Supreme Court, which strikes down a particular act, and that particular act is picked up and put in the ninth schedule without more, you don't change the basis. Straight away without more, the act is revived and the judgment goes. Now that is contrary totally to judicial review as we understand it, and as I have just expounded it. So another way of either striking down the last part of 31B or of reading it down would have been, in my submission, to say that, look, it is only those acts where an amendment has taken place in those acts, where the law is now completely, fundamentally changed, and then goes into the ninth schedule, that 31B would apply, and not otherwise. That again would have been a very, very important taking out the sting of 31B. Because, and unfortunately, the Supreme Court didn't realize that it had a model before it. In the Indira Gandhi case, which I had adverted to earlier in 1975, you remember that I spoke about 329A, which, in short, put the Prime Minister and the Speaker above the law. Now, apart from putting them above the law, Mrs. Gandhi was also very clear in doing one other thing, which is to change certain parts of the Representation of People Act itself. One of the important changes she made was that we'll have a new definition of candidate. Why? Because she was non-seated by the Allahabad High Court, fundamentally on the footing that there was a corrupt practice that she had indulged in, because her agent, Yashpal Kapoor, had in fact utilized much more money than he was entitled to under the Representation of People Act, which came from party funds. So one easy way out was to say, look, we'll change the definition of candidate to say that a person is a candidate only once he is nominated. Now, the moment you say a candidate is a candidate once he is nominated, everything pre-nomination is washed out and would no longer be a corrupt practice. And that is exactly what was done. So what was held in that Indira Gandhi judgment of 5 was that features. You upheld the act because it did not directly encroach on the judicial function. Why? You had changed the basis. Now, unfortunately, again, this is one other way in which the Supreme Court could have read 31B and completely removed its sting by saying that, look, see what Indira Gandhi's judgment did. It's only in cases of that type where you first change the basis of the law and then put it in the ninth schedule that it will receive protection, not otherwise. Now, unfortunately, that again was not followed. So two golden opportunities were missed. One, confine it to agrarian reform, which would have been very easy. And second, that it can only apply in cases where the basis of the law has changed and not otherwise. Now, instead of all this, what did the Supreme Court actually finally do? Big question mark. In para 148 of the judgment, it's a long judgment setting out all the previous history, But then when we come to the nitty-gritty, what do we find? We find that there is tremendous confusion, conceptually. And the confusion is this. You now have a two-tier test. Earlier, you didn't have any two-tier test for violation of fundamental rights and basic structure. Now what they say is, every law that is put into the ninth schedule, after Keshavananda Bharti's case, that's after April 73, is liable now to be tested on two counts. First, does it violate any fundamental right? If the answer is yes, you then go to the second. And the second is, does it also then violate basic structure? Now, I thought that the entirety of the judgment was that, yes, fundamental rights are part of basic structure. Now, if fundamental rights are part of basic structure, where does the second test come in? And the other problem now is that in the concluding paragraph, there is a specific sentence which unfortunately says that the second test really applies because there are certain fundamental rights which may not be part of basic structure. So we are not again at all clear in this judgment as to what it means. Does it go back to the old core and penumbra theory? That is, if only you violate the core, let us say of 19(1)(a), take an example, take freedom of the press. You'll recall that the Bennett Coleman and Sakal papers judgments were both judgments which struck down newsprint laws. And what did they do? One raised a tax on newsprint, and one added, or rather curtailed, the extent of newsprint that a newspaper could possibly use. Now, both these are violations of 19(1)(a) in an oblique sense. It doesn't go to the core of the right. It doesn't stop either the content of what the newspaper could print or the printing itself. So it would be possible now under this two-tier test to say that if any of those acts are put in the ninth schedule, those acts may well violate 19(1)(a) because of Bennett, Coleman and Sakal, but they would not violate basic structure because they are at the penumbra of the right, not the core. I don't know if this is what the judgment means. Second problem, if this is not what the judgment means, then it becomes even worse to make a distinction between some rights and others, and to say that some rights are more fundamental than others. Because Chapter 3 doesn't differentiate. Every single right in that right is a fundamental right. It's very difficult then to say that we will regard 14 as fundamental, 19 as fundamental, 21 as fundamental, but not 22, for example, for whatever reason, or not 29, or not 30. Or not 18. Take the best example for the other side. Abolition of titles. Abolition of titles doesn't really go, to any fundamental freedom. It's all right if you can't get a title. The title can't be conferred by this state or by any foreign nation. It's all right. But the chapter, unfortunately, doesn't say so. And the other confusion in the judgment is that it keeps talking of 21 read with 14 and 19. Now, what if 21 is by itself? What if 14 is by itself? What if 19 is by itself? Then what is to happen? Because very often, high courts read these judgments as if they were statutes. And when they so read the judgment, a judge could possibly say, look, there's no challenge under all the three articles. There's only a challenge under 14. That may not be good enough. So all these questions therefore arise, and unfortunately in my submission, not only does the judgment not really answer anything except one thing, that certain fundamental rights are part of the basic structure, but it also unfortunately missed a golden opportunity because it was untrammeled by benches of 5 and 7. It was 9 now. And being so untrammeled, it could very easily have held that, look, we confine 31B to agrarian reform, as I said earlier, or at the very least say that in accordance with Keshavananda Bharti's case, Minerva Mills case, Vaman Rao, etc., we find that now judicial review is an evolving concept. and has evolved since 1973. You have struck down certain parts of the Constitution on the ground that they violate 31 judicial review. For example, Keshavananda's case itself, if you remember, struck down the last part of 31C. Now, the last part of 31C only said that in judging whether a law is made in pursuance of a directive principle, courts will not be able to say whether it is in fact made in furtherance of that principle or not. That limited judicial review that was taken away was said to be bad by 7 out of 13 judges. 31B is of a far, far more egregious nature. Because what 31B does, in fact, is to declare by way of judgment, straight away without more, that though a certain thing has been struck down by a high court on the ground of violation of fundamental rights, without more, the moment we put it in the ninth schedule, the act resuscitates and the judgment goes, which is far, far more egregious. So if something as small as this last part of 31C was struck down on the ground of judicial review, this should have followed. Equally, in the Minerva Mills case, when you struck down 368, 4 and 5, which tried to undo Keshavananda Bharti and tried to say that any constitutional amendment can be passed by us, the court said no, and correctly. And one of the prime reasons that it said no was, it is for courts ultimately to declare and decide. Again, judicial review. The same thing was said in Bhim Singh Ji and in Vaman Rao. You could have used all these judgments as precedents, as binding precedents also, to say that, according to us, judicial review as it has now developed is totally incompatible with the last part of 31B, which is mere declaratory judgment without. None of these things, unfortunately, are found in the judgment. And I suppose lawyers alone will live to reap harvests another day, because this will now go on and on, and nine judges probably will have to be explained by 11, and I don't know what 11 will do after all this. But the upshot of the entire discussion now, and I'll end on this note, is that according to me, most unfortunately, the court has missed a golden opportunity to lay down with great clarity that all fundamental rights are part of basic structure, and that 31B is today a weapon which no longer can be used. Thank you very much.